In our today's lecture, we will cover the ventricular skeleton, and the ventricular skeleton consists of the clavicle, which is also called the collarbone, scapula, and the bones of the upper limbs. So before discussing them individually, let's look at their images. The first bone that we are going to talk is the clavicle bone, and this is the right clavicle bone. The first point is its shape. Its shape is roughly S-shaped. So we can say that the clavicle is a roughly S-shaped bone. It has a sternal end that is going to articulate with the manubrium of the sternum that we have already discussed in our previous lecture when we studied the rib cage. So this sternal end will join with the manubrium of the sternum and form the sternoclavicular joint. This part of the clavicle, called the body of the clavicle, this end is the acromial end or the lateral end. This is going to take part in the formation of another joint, which is the acromioclavicular joint. Acromial is the acromial process of the scapula. This process, the acromial process of the scapula, and this acromial end of the clavicle will join with the acromial process of the scapula and form a joint which is called the acromioclavicular joint at its lateral end. If we look at the clavicle bone from the inferior aspect, you can appreciate another projection, which is the conoid tubercle. So this tubercle is basically for the conoid ligament, and this ligament is part of the coracoclavicular ligament, which attaches the clavicle to the coracoid process of the scapula. But this is the coracoid process of the scapula. So the tubercle which is going to attach at the conoid tubercle is basically attaches the clavicle with the scapula, the coracoid process of the scapula. And the clavicle has an interior surface, posterior surface, the medial and the lateral borders. Now we will talk about the scapula. Just like the clavicle, the scapula also has a lateral border and a medial border. And just remember that the lateral border is that where there will be the glenoid fossa, and we will discuss about the importance of the glenoid fossa later. Just remember that this is the lateral border, this is the medial border, that is more towards the medial side of your body. This is the subscapular fossa, the superior angle, the superior border just below the superior angle, the acromion process at its lateral end, and the coracoid process, which is a beak-like process. And this is the glenoid fossa, which basically accommodates the head of the humerus and takes part in the formation of the shoulder joint. So now we will discuss about the bones of the upper limb. And the first bone that we are going to talk about is the humerus. Humerus has approximate, it is a long bone first of all, and it has a proximal end and it has a distal end. At its proximal end, as you can see, it has a head, and this head will take part in the formation of the shoulder joint with the glenoid fossa, and the head is much bigger than the glenoid fossa. And to stabilize the shoulder joint, the shoulder joint is not that stabilized as compared to the hip joint, but there are ligaments, the extracapsular and the intracapsular ligaments, that provides the stabilization of the shoulder joint. So this is the head at its proximal part, and this is going to take part in the formation of the shoulder joint. Next is the lesser tubercle and the greater tubercle. And between them you can appreciate the intertubercular sulcus or the bicipital groove. We call it the bicipital groove because in this groove the long head of the biceps brachii muscle runs. At its distal end you can appreciate various parts, and this is the olecranon fossa that forms the elbow joint, and it accommodates the olecranon process of the ulna and takes part in the formation of the elbow joint. This is the trochlea. This is the trochlea, and this trochlea will accommodate the trochlear notch of the ulna and take part in the formation of the elbow joint. This is the capitulum, and the capitulum will accommodate the head of the radius, and once again it will form the elbow joint with radius. So these are the important landmarks for the articular surfaces to form the elbow joint. Next we will talk about the radius and the ulna. Just like the humerus, the radius and ulna also have proximal and the distal parts. So the first point that we are going to talk about is the radius. This is its proximal part. You can appreciate the head of the humerus, and this head of the humerus is going to articulate with the capitulum of the humerus that was present on the distal end of the humerus. So you can see that this capitulum will accommodate the head of the radius. Next is this narrow part, which is the neck of the radius. The radial tuberosity, this projection here, the shaft at its distal end, you can appreciate the ulnar notch, the styloid process. Styloid process is basically for the muscles and ligament attachment, and this styloid, the ulnar notch is basically for the joint between the radius and the ulna. If we look at the ulna, you can appreciate the radial notch, and this radial notch will form the radio ulnar joint at their proximal end. So basically the radius and ulna both form the radio ulnar joint at their proximal and distal parts. The coronoid process, the trochlear notch, and this trochlear notch will be accommodated by this trochlea on the distal end of the humerus. Here is the olecranon process of the ulna. that is going to be accommodated by the olecranon fossa of the humerus, and it will take part in the formation of the elbow joint. Next, we have the carpal bones, and the carpal bones are arranged in a distal row and a proximal row, and each row will contain four carpal bones, and this is a mnemonic for you to memorize the sequence of the carpal bones. These are the phalanges of the hand, and you can appreciate the metacarpal bones, and the metacarpal bones would have a base, a shaft, and a head. Then comes the proximal phalanges, the intermediate phalanges, and the distal phalanges. In the thumb, we have the proximal and the distal phalanges only. The intermediate phalanges will be absent in the thumb. So there will be total 14 phalanges in the hand. Now we will discuss them individually. So starting with the appendicular skeleton. The appendicular skeleton consists of the shoulder girdle with the upper limbs, the pelvic girdle with the lower limbs. The shoulder girdle consists of two clavicles and the two scapula. Clavicle, which is also called the collarbone. This clavicle is an roughly shaped S-shaped long bone. It articulates with the manubrium of the sternum at the sternoclavicular joint, and forms the acromioclavicular joint with the acromion process of the scapula. The clavicle provides the only link between the upper limb and the axial skeleton. So we have two joints at the sternal end with the manubrium of the sternum, and at the acromion end with the acromion process of the scapula. Next is the scapula, which is also called the shoulder blade. The scapula is a flat triangular shaped bone lying on the posterior chest wall, superficial to the ribs and separated from them by the muscles. At the lateral angle is a shallow articular surface, the glenoid cavity, which with the head of the humerus forms the shoulder joint. So this is the glenoid fossa or the glenoid cavity. For the formation of the shoulder joint, it is going to articulate with the head of the humerus, and then they will form the shoulder joint. On the posterior surface runs a rough ridge called the spine, which extends beyond the lateral border of the scapula and overhangs the glenoid cavity. The prominent overhang, which can be felt through the skin as the highest point of the shoulder, is called the acromion process and forms a joint with the clavicle, the acromial clavicular joint, a slightly movable synovial joint that contributes to the mobility of the shoulder girdle. The coracoid process is a projection from the upper border of the bone that gives attachments to the muscles that move the shoulder joint. So this is basically the interior part of the interior surface of the scapula, and the first thing is that this is a triangular shaped flat bone, and at its posterior part there is coming a spine, and it is forming a overhang that you can feel over your skin at the posterior chest wall, and this is forming an acromion process that you can feel. This is the beak like coracoid process, and this subscapular fossa basically accommodates the subscapularis muscle. Next is the upper limb. And the first bone that we are going to talk about is the humerus. This is the bone of the upper limb. The head sits within the glenoid cavity of the scapula, forming the shoulder joint. Distal to the head are two roughened projections of the bone, the greater and the lesser tubercles, and between them there is a deep groove, the bicipital groove or intertubercular sulcus, occupied by one of the tendons of the biceps muscle. The distal end of the bone presents two surfaces that articulate with the radius and ulna to form the elbow joint. So once again, the head of the humerus is going to take part in the formation of the shoulder joint, the lesser tubercle and the greater tubercle, and between these two tubercles you can appreciate the intertubercular sulcus or the bicipital groove, which is going to accommodate the long head of the biceps brachii muscle. At its distal part you can appreciate the olecranon fossa for the accommodation of the olecranon process of the ulna, the trochlea and the capitulum. Capitulum will accommodate the head of the radius, and the trochlea will accommodate the trochlear notch, or we can say that this trochlea will articulate with the trochlear notch and will form the elbow joint. Now we will talk about the radius and the ulna. And these are the two bones of the forearm. The ulna is longer than the radius, and it lies medial to the radius. And when the arm is in the anatomical position, that is with the palm of the hand facing forward, the two bones are parallel. They articulate with the humerus at the elbow joint, the carpal bones at the wrist joint, and with each other at the proximal and the distal radioulnar joints. In addition, an interosseous membrane, a fibrous joint, connects the bones along their shafts, stabilizing their association and maintaining their relative positions despite forces applied from the elbow or wrist. So once again, there we have the proximal part of the radius, the proximal part of the ulna, and at their proximal parts they are going to take part in the formation of the elbow joint, and they will also form a joint with each other, and we will call that joint the proximal radioulnar joint. At the distal ends they will form the joint with the wrist. They will form a joint that is called the wrist joint with the carpal bones, and with each other, that is called the distal radioulnar joint. And another important thing is that the ulna lies medially, and the radius bone lies laterally. Next we have the carpal wrist bones. There are 8 carpal bones arranged in 2 rows of 4. From outside inwards, they are in the proximal row. We have scaphoid, lunate, triquetrium and the pisiform bone. And in the distal row we have trapezium, trapezoid, capitate and hemate. Now we will look at the image. So you can see that they are arranged in 2 rows, and in the proximal row we have the scaphoid, lunate, triquetrium and the pisiform bone. Once again, in the proximal row we have 4 bones, and these are the scaphoid, lunate, triquetrium and the pisiform bone. At the distal row you can appreciate 4 bones, and these are the trapezium, trapezoid, decapitate and hematite. So to remember these carpal bones, there is a mnemonic that can help you to memorize the sequence. These bones are closely fitted together and held in position by the ligaments that allow a limited amount of movement between them. The bones of the proximal row are associated with the wrist joint, and those of the distal row form joints with the metacarpal bones. Tendons of muscles lying in the forearm cross the wrist and are held close to the bones by the strong fibrous hands called the retinacula that we have already discussed. So the proximal carpal bones will take part in the formation of the wrist joint, and those lying in the distal row will form the joint with the metacarpal bones. Then we have the metacarpal bones. These five bones form the palm of the hand, and they are numbered from the thumb side inwards. The proximal ends articulate with the carpal bones and the distal ends with the phalanges. Phalanges, they are total 14 in number, 3 in each finger and 2 in the thumb. And they articulate with the metacarpal bones with at their proximal end and with each other by the hinge joints. So here you can see that the carpal bones, the distal row of the carpal bones is forming a joint with the metacarpal bones. Metacarpal bones at the proximal end are forming joint with the carpal bones, and at the distal end they are forming a joint with the proximal phalanges, and the proximal phalanges are forming a joint at the proximal part with the metacarpal bones and at their distal part with the intermediate phalanges. And there are total 3 phalanges in the fingers and 2 in the thumb, proximal, intermediate and the distal phalanges. And the phalanges would have a head, that would be the head, the body and the base, and the distal phalanges have an extra landmark, that is the tubercle. So the distal phalanges would have a tubercle, a head, shaft or body and a base. So that's all for today, and if you have any question regarding this lecture, then you can ask. Thank you so much.